Hello, Mr. Geomologist. This is Kasia. It has taken me a hot minute to call in because I think I might be caught in dreamland. I take Admiral out. I let Admiral talk to people. Admiral become dog. It was very weird. I didn't think anybody was smoking nearby. Maybe they were. Anyways, I don't know. He was acting very weird. I get him back over to ambulance. You know, there was a little bit of shooting at people. You know, the normal. Sometimes you just have to take people out, make a little bit of a statement. I think Chernoff actually shot them in the head with an arrow. So I think he got the point, if you get my point. But then I turn around and Jonesy, he gets shot. I don't understand. One minute I'm dealing with the Admiral, the next minute Jonesy is dead. This is not part of the plan, not a good idea. So now I have to finish mission on my own, but I think what's going to happen now is Diego is now my dog, and I have to tell Diego. So now I have to figure out a way of explaining to the dog that his human is not coming back. But maybe the dog won't notice. I will be working on that for the next time. But first, I have to go get helicopter. Jonesy would want me to get helicopter and do something with this little thing that he's hiding from everybody else. Something about the reset. Anyways, I talk to you soon.
The Geomologist, GM Extraordinaire, the Geomologist.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Geomologist Presents. Good show for you today. The main topic is going to be, well, the after action report for our latest Twilight 2000 game. And as you can see by the title, I'm spoiling it already, one of the player characters died, Jonesy, one of the original group who fled from Kalitz when we started this campaign a couple years ago, has gone, you know, a couple players have played Jonesy, but the player who played him the most has had him for almost that length of time, the whole 2 years. So yeah, it was pretty shocking, I think. Although I think one person did say they're surprised that someone hasn't died before, but I will get to that, I think, when I give the recap. But we also have some call-ins, for the last couple of podcasts that I put out. So a call-in by Joe Richter and a call-in by Jason Connerly. And then you also are going to get, as you heard at the beginning, you'll get bracketed by calls from the T2K Alternate Universe by Kasia Nanayura-Bazinski. And she kind of gives her perspective on some of the events that happened. So there you go. That's the show. So on with it. First up is Joe Richter.
Yo, Carl, just calling in to let you know that I thought your latest episode, which I actually watched on YouTube, the one with you and Amy running that scene, Admiral Interrogation, was awesome, man. That was so friggin' cool. It's just great that the two of you can do that kind of stuff, right? That you have these shared interests and stuff. Because, yeah, it's not... It's not every couple that can play one-on-one RPGs. Trust me, I know a few that would not be able to do it. And the fact that you guys can is just awesome and speaks volumes So yeah, thank you for putting that out. Great stuff, and keep up the good work, dude. Peace out.
Hey, Joe, thank you so much for the call, and thank you for watching the YouTube. I feel like the YouTube has gotten, per episode, more hits than the podcast, which is pretty cool. I mean, in general, the ones that I put out, not just with Amy, but with BJ Boyd of the Arcane Alienist, and we've done this, our Marvel Three Dice and the Truth type of thing. And we did a segment on We Deal in Lead, which I thought was really good character creation there. So so yeah, Amy's awesome. It's great to be able to play games. We haven't always played games. I feel like it's more of a recent development in our marriage. She's kind of let me do that thing. She's joined a game here and there, but was, I guess early on was a little discouraged maybe by people that she played with and them sort of sidelining her role in the game. But she's definitely, when we play solo and then she joins a group, she's definitely become more confident. So we have done some other solo stuff. We've done Cthulhu Confidential. We did start our Call of Cthulhu 7th edition game with her where she played Keiko Kane. I think it was Paper Chase, which I think you're familiar with that adventure from the Call of Cthulhu starter set. And then that has taken off where we kind of played solo with her 5 years later after she graduates from medical school and is a resident at Arkham Asylum in Arkham in Massachusetts. So, and also an appointment with Miskatonic University. And a friend of ours has joined us. My friend Anne has joined us to keep playing in that sort of Call of Cthulhu classic 1920s campaign set in Arkham. And then we did roll up a character for Traveler, an Aslan envoy, that of course, and then Amy, this envoy has a ship, has a crew. So I don't know what I'm going to do with that yet. I don't know even where I want to put them, whether in sort of near Third Imperium space or further out to Spinward, out on the frontier. It's a very cool character that she made, so that might be coming at some point. I don't know. And then, well, Twilight 2000, you hear her playing Kasia, none of your Baczynski, and which obviously is not that character's real name. And that character has a really interesting past that Amy has developed over the course of play. It wasn't like she just played it initially, and then her backstory sort of developed in her mind, and she's kind of adapted her play of that character to that. So I think it's really cool. And again, thanks for calling. And definitely this encourages Amy. She loves to hear that kind of stuff. Yeah, I mean, she does get into the voices sometimes. Oh, she's also joined in recently with the Marvel game as a Vampire Jubilee in our Marvel game with BJ Boyd as Agent, what is it? Agent X? No, Agent 45? Agent 45, yeah. Something like that. So that's kind of cool too. But definitely appreciate the call and encouraging Amy.
Carry on my wayward son. There'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest. Don't you cry no more.
Hey, Carl, Jason here, just listening to Season 5, Episode 20. So you say one of the hallmarks of this GM group is to run games honestly. Can you expand on that, what run games honestly means? And is having a ringer in your group go against the idea of running a game honestly? Maybe talk about that. Now, full disclosure, I don't think having a known player in your group goes against the idea of running a game honestly and not stacking the odds, because I think there's makes sense to have somebody there that you, the GM, are comfortable with and somebody there that's probably already comfortable with the rules. I think that can make things easier, so I don't think there's an issue with that. But I am curious on this idea of a ringer if you mean something other than just that. Are you expecting that ringer to do certain things during the game? In which case, I question whether the game's being run honestly. And then the expansion of the thought of running games honestly. Thank you.
All right, let's talk about Ford GM first, and then I'll answer the other question. So Ford RPG, they want to run other games besides D&D, so they want to be more encompassing of the games that are out there. They're always willing to teach the game regardless of the experience level, and they use, maybe this is what I mean by an honest GM, they use a yes and GM style, a non-adversarial GM style, as opposed to a gotcha GM style. And truth be told, I think most of the GMs that I play with do not have that style. It's always about, oh, what can the players bring to the table? And I'm going to run with what the players come up with and make it fun for everyone. And I think that is the goal at any table. So I guess that's what I mean by honest GM. Maybe it's a misuse of that term, but kind of that's what I mean. And that's why I like these guys and have joined their group. That is not to say they don't not play D&D, but I think, actually, I don't know. I think what they're trying to do is actually play more types of D&D or more types of fantasy games other than WotC D&D 5th edition, which is extremely prevalent, as you know. So, you know, I've seen all sorts of different games, like I mentioned, the Modifius games, Free League games, previous iterations of D&D, the Morkborg, Pirate Borg, indie games galore. So I think that's pretty cool. And I feel like it makes it for more like it's not me, the GM, versus you. It's us trying to tell a story together. So I think that's what's pretty cool. And I think I probably misused ringer. I guess what I mean is like ally, and it's like I said, Amy has never been exposed to the Operation Ocelot scenario, but had played Modifius 2d20 Octoon Cthulhu before in a different game. So but ally is probably a more appropriate term than ringer, and maybe again I misuse that term, but an ally is good to have, someone who is familiar with the game, or someone who's just a friend, even if they're not familiar with the game. Which I think is a good idea, pretty cool. And they can, you know, give some confidence to a GM who's running the game for strangers, mostly strangers. So I think that's what I appreciate about Amy joining the game. She also likes Octoon Cthulhu and, you know, wants to play it. So I think that's a cool thing too. All right, well, thanks for the call, Jason. And now on to what happened in our latest episode session of Twilight 2000. All right, as I approach giving a recap of what happened in our latest Twilight 2000 session, I organize my thoughts and hopefully I can get everything. It was a really good session. We had two new players. TJ has joined us and he's a red leg, so a mortar and heavy weapons specialist American. And Paul has also joined us, and he rolled up like an old country doctor, but actually more of a veterinarian. So it was pretty interesting. Also, because I guess there was a need for vets at this point in the war. So he's also German vet who was serving in the German army. So very interesting. So that means, well, we have seven players now in the game. So the game has been bolstered by new blood. One of the players was absent, so we had six players at the table. And I also wanted to kind of give a little bit of behind the curtain and my thought process and how everything really just came about oddly and randomly. Because I guess sometimes that's what happens. So we had before this game, we had rolled opposed recon checks between the Free Krakow Coalition, team, which consisted of a BMP-3 that they had commandeered earlier from some Soviets or a Soviet marauder group, a GAZ-66, which they also stole from some Russians, and they had an M113, which was the group of survivors they had rescued from a warlord that were a mix of German and Americans who were rescued and then said, hey, we know we ditched our M113. Can you help us go get it? And they did. So that was a column of the Free Krakow Coalition members. And then they had spotted a column that they knew was approaching. They weren't able to set up a proper ambush, so they had to rush to it. But they spotted another column of the Baron's resupply group, which consisted of a Zill truck flanked on either side by two OT-64s, the Polish equivalent of BTR-70s. So not tracked, but a wheeled armored fighting vehicle, as opposed to the BMP-3, which is a tracked fighting vehicle that has actually a pretty damn good arsenal. So the player character saw what was happening, and Kasia, as you heard in Admiral interrogation, had interrogated the Admiral. And the Admiral was like, at this point, he's still injured. He's been drugged up. He's been kind of broken by the good cop, bad cop interrogations between what Jonesy did at the hospital previously and then Kasia's talking to him for the last hour or so in the back of the Russian hospital truck, the GAZ-66. So upon hearing that they've spotted the enemy, Kasia, the other two fighting vehicles kind of head off road and get themselves into a position where, if necessary, they can fire upon the convoy, the Black Baron's convoy. And very quickly, Sumner, the new player played by TJ, gets the 120 millimeter mortar out of the back, or drags it out of the back of the BMP-3, and sets it up and starts trying to sight or kind of peek over the bushes and rocks and sight where this enemy convoy is coming. Meantime, the M113 also goes off to the side and is there kind of as a reserve. And just in case, it has a 50 cal, so it doesn't have the heavy weaponry that the BMP-3 or the mortar can provide. And then the truck, the hospital truck, kind of drives forward. And then this is when I rolled, right, so they're not trying to hide. And this is when I rolled the disposition, or actually drew a card for the disposition of the convoy. And when I rolled, it kind of suggested that these people were novices and not really paying attention. So with that sort of tag or prompt, I just had them follow up, maybe a little curious of what's going on. They see a Russian truck. And then Amy's character gets out, Kasia, dragging the Admiral, and is saying, you know, take this. This is the Admiral. I'm giving him to you. Right. So it's kind of trying to use him as a distraction, at the very least, or at the very best. Maybe the Admiral could order these people, being a person of authority in the Black Baron's marauder group, maybe order these people to stand down. Well, that's not what happened, because then I drew another card, and it said wrecked for the disposition of the Admiral. So I had him just act broken. So he kind of tried to get loose from Kasia, and he crawled forward. And said, please help me, please. I am a sorry. I apologize to the Baron for my failure. It was kind of a unfortunate mess, right? And things, well, escalated into violence very quickly after that. So Kasia was pointing the gun at the, and in the group, so it looks like some people started getting out of the vehicles from the other group to like stretch their legs or whatever. And out of the lead OTR, there was like one person came out, seemed to be the commander, and a couple people came out who had AKs, probably AKMs. And then also the Saint had climbed to the top of the GAZ-66, as a sniper. Grunts had climbed up to some rocks, kind of injuring himself to act as an overwatch as a sniper. And Chernoff had snuck out of the M113 through the brush to find a good position with his loaded crossbow, just in case things went south as they looked like they were going. Jonesy and the new doctor, I think his name is Yager or something like that. And the new doctor, the doctor's name is Jorg Loggenberg, so I'll probably refer to him as Dr. Loggenberg. They're still in the cab of the GAZ 66 as this is playing out. And then, the guy raises his rifle, this OT-64 commander or whatever. Maybe he's a leader of the expedition. Although Grunts is sighted on the truck and he sees a guy on a radio too. So that guy might be the leader of this little expedition. The guy raises a rifle to Kasia. Kasha's threatening him. And then Chernov shoots him. With the crossbow, hits him in the stomach. And it's a critical wound. And it kind of like tears up his intestines. The guy crumples over. Then the Saint is able to go. So really, I ruled that. And when this happened, I just rolled for the escalation to happen, for this guy to become hostile, apparently hostile, this Marauder, a Black Baron guy, Black Baron's person. I rolled sort of a 2d6 old school D&D style and rolled a 3, so that's kind of hostile. So so it was random that this kind of escalated, in my opinion. And then, Chernov shoots a guy, hits a guy with the crossbow, takes him out. The game's very interesting. And I've reiterated, it's pretty deadly. So most player characters and opposition have between 4 and 6 quote-unquote hit points. It's like damage. They also have a stress track that is from 4 to 6 points as well. And then, if that goes to 0, you're defeated. But what kills you are critical wounds. And that's kind of what took down this trooper. So like they have troops, lieutenants, nemesis, as you see in other kind of free league type games where some troops are better than others type of thing, but everyone still has a certain number of damage that they can take. And again, and then whether they have armor or not can mitigate it. But anyway, for guys that really aren't in a way nameless or, you know, faceless in a way, a critical wound takes them down. A more substantial enemy, significant enemy, right? They're gonna be treated like a player characters when it comes to that. But a critical wound can instantly kill you, as we will find out soon enough. So the Saint opens up from his hidden position, takes out those two other guys in front of the OT-64. I roll, and then Grunts shoots the driver of the truck. And meanwhile, the new red leg, played by TJ Sumner, has been trying to sight in. It took him a little bit of time, and it's a good thing there was a delay. But he finally as soon as he heard the shooting, he had sighted in his mortar onto the back OT-64, and he lets loose. He hits, there is a crater, destroys the vehicle. Everyone inside it is pretty much killed. He just a penetrating hit that the explosion inside, the shell penetrating the top of the OT-64, and then the explosion inside kills the occupants, and the vehicle's destroyed. And it also, the explosion is big enough that Marauders who were outside stretching their legs that got out of the back of the truck also get injured. It's a big mess, and the fighting keeps going. I kind of ruled. I drew initiative at that point, which is a 1 to 10, with 1 being the best. Just use cards that they provide for you. So I use kind of a deck of cards where I've taken out all the face cards on the roll 20 and assigned them.
It gets pretty messy very quickly for the people in the column, the Marauder column. So then the ones in the OT-64 that saw their comrades gunned down fail their coolness under fire, so they're kind of like figuring out, very confused, trying to figure out what to do. So they're down for a round. Others try to flank out and get out of the kill zone after seeing this big explosion in the back of their vehicle. Jonesy and Dr. Lagenberg kind of jump out of the gas. Jonesy goes north of the road into some brush. Dr. Lagenberg joins Chernoff, and Chernoff helps him hunker down behind some rocks, as well as brush, and they lay suppressive fire, or he lays suppressive fire. Grunts shoots the radio men. Sumner runs back into the back of the BMP-3, gets on the AGS, which is a grenade launcher, and fires a grenade at the lead vehicle and rolls well enough to penetrate it. You got a good hit on that. The ammo inside cooks off. People are running out of that vehicle as well. And there is some subsequent damage to the truck as well, and there's like a fuel leak on it. So that truck has a fuel leak. It doesn't explode, but it's just a big mess. So it looks like the Free Krakow Coalition has kind of got these guys. They're taking him down. But then at least one of the Marauders gets some return fire. Actually, three of the Marauders get some return fire. The two to the south fire at the position where Chernov and Dr. Lagenberg are, and just, you know, hit rocks. These guys are undercover. They can't really see where they are. Jonesy, though, running through the brush, is an apparent target. And the one Marauder takes a shot at him. And it's a quick shot. And it's through cover. The range was not a problem. So I subtracted two dice from the Marauder. So he was rolling at 2d6. But then they're kind of desperate. So opening up. Yeah, the other curious thing is, like, all these guys who, except for the guys in the lead OT-64 who bailed out and are running around because of the shots going everywhere. The guys who were in the back of the truck, they all made their coolness under fire, despite getting, you know, hit with shrapnel and, you know, fiery debris from the OT-64 that blew up behind them. So while Grunts, you know, finishes off, or people finish off the guy, the driver and the other guy, the radio man in the truck, and the OT-64 guys are running around, one Marauder does get a shot off, and it's a DD, so I need a 6 to succeed, and I hit Jonesy. And then it did damage. It was enough for a critical wound, and I had asked the player, does Jonesy have a flak jacket, because that could have mitigated the damage and actually made it not a crit, I believe. But he did not have a flak jacket, he said, and he got hit in the chest, and then I had the player roll their fate, so it's a critical hit. He rolled a 10, which is the worst you can get if you like your player. A 10 chest hit is shot through the heart, instant death. So Jonesy is dead. And then Kasia's reaction, she had dragged, when the shooting started, she had dragged the Admiral back behind cover of the hospital truck, the ambulance. And she probably yelled at Jonesy to stay down, because, I mean, really, they had these guys, right? I mean, between the sniper, the sniper and the hidden positions of the Saint and Grunts, and then the kind of, if necessary, the BMP could have driven up and started opening fire too with its PK, or even with the 30mm, although that would have been overkill. And then with the 50 cal, the M113, you know, it was, anyway. Jonesy, in hindsight, right? Anyway, so Kasia sees this, she's horrified. She steps out from cover, and I was like, oh crap, if Kasia doesn't gun this guy down, because she's not a great shot, she could die too. because this guy's still up and active and there's still some other combatants around. But she opens fire and kills the guy. So at least gets her immediate bit of revenge and then, you know, runs towards Jonesy's body. Meanwhile, the other guys are getting mopped up, shot up, and three of them finally, Dr. Lagenberg, kind of, you know, is a doctor, not necessarily want to kill people, but asks for their surrender. Chernov agrees, and they both command and persuade the combatants to surrender. They take three prisoners, and Lagenberg goes to see what he can do with them. They're all injured and shot up, get hit with shrapnel and stuff. So the combat is ended. They get a lot of loot, but now the player's got to process. One of the members died. And this is surprising in that it is a lethal game like I described. This is the first death we've had. Jonesy's been shot up. He got shot and lost an ear. So that could have been dead there. Head hit, you know, no helmet. Got his ear shot off. It was a critical hit. Kasia later, you know, put it back on, attached it back on. And he lost his leg too and almost bled out. But Kasia has actually been very miraculous and almost saint-like in her battlefield medical prowess. She spent Amy spent the XP to get that up and high when necessary. So she saved Jonesy. She saved Liam when he got hit in the neck and was bleeding like a fountain out, you know, throw that powder, inject that morphine, you know, stabilize him, stop the bleeding. And, you know, and Kasia has suffered a broken hip. She got shot in the leg pretty bad and got taken down, but it wasn't a crit. Actually, by the saint, Jonesy brought her back. Chernov has been shot and got a gut shot, but it ended up not being a crit. And then Grunts has been injured here and there. So everyone's kind of been hurt and shot, but this time, well, it was fatal. So yes, it was some interesting comments, and I probably will pick up the next session. I mean, as they kind of loot the bodies, take stock of what they've gathered, you know, we kind of already went through what was in the back of the truck. The OT-64s there's one's like shot. I mean, one's totally gone. One's like a burning husk, and the other one's it's like a cheese grater. It's like Swiss cheese, like all the 50 cal bullets going off inside of it. They could probably recover the KPV on it. But I don't think much. But they found some good stuff. But I think I will give them all an opportunity to process the death of Jonesy the next time we pick up. I think it was an abrupt death and very surprising. Bad luck, one player said. Another player said that they loved their contribution as a newbie in the group, but the victory seemed hollow with the death of Jonesy. So yeah, it was good. I think it kind of brings up a question. I'm definitely going to have this on another podcast. I probably have a special guest with me. We've talked about this on some Discords. How important is player death, or is it important in your game? And I think, it was a great session. Meaningful session, actually. And we'll see how the Free Cow Coalition goes on from here. There's definitely talk of vengeance. Are they going to immediately kill the Admiral? They definitely want to go after the Black Baron. The mission is still there. We need to go find that that helicopter, because that would be a great help in the battle for Warsaw, which is coming. So anyway, they did get some key intel, like you heard, in the Admiral interrogation. So we'll see how they process that and continue forward. They definitely don't like the Black Baron now, or at least Kasia doesn't. So that's it. So thank you for listening. And I think, it'd be great to hear your responses, your calls and comments. So you can do that at gmologist@gmail.com. Send me a message also on the Discord. You can drop me a line, either a message or a voicemail message. Voice message. I have a SpeakPub account. You can leave about a 90-second message. And TJ Drennan does the intro and outro music. The cool riffs that he came up with are amazing. All his fun stuff, and you hear his music and contribution to our little podcasty group all over the place. So it's great. And then Amy, my wife Amy, usually does a cover clip art, but today the art is from, it's a picture of Jonesy and Kasia kind of chatting shortly after Kalitz. It's a two-page spread, I believe, done by Martin Grip. Yes, that's correct. Martin Grip, I believe, does these two-page spreads that are at the beginning of every chapter in the Player's Guide and the Twilight 2000 box set. So yeah, and I guess we're going to end with another message from Kasia. This one a bit more somber, sober, and after that, the outro music. So thank you so much for listening. Good night and good rolling.
This is Kasia, none of your Beninsky, calling from the front line. We have battle. Three of enemy are alive, but not because of me, because of the vet. There was a grave injustice. One of them shot my Jonesy. Now I do not have him. I was very angry, and I unloaded into guy that shot him. But it did not make me feel better. I blame the Black Baron for what has happened. He is a coward. He does not leave where he is at to stand up and face what he has done. So now I have to go to him. I will have my vengeance. And I will avenge Jonesy for Diego, who is now my dog. Now I have two dogs, Diego and Boy. Not certain if I need two dogs. Not certain. But I love both, so we'll probably keep both. I have to go, because now I need to plot.